So hello again. In the previous lectures, we were discussing about Faison's rule. So what was Faison's rule? Faison's rule was talking about covalent character in ionic compound. So basically, no bond, whether ionic or covalent, is purely ionic or covalent. But there are some percentage, if we talk about ionic bond here, there is some amount or some percentage of covalent character in an ionic bond, and that was basically talked about by Faison. So according to Faison, ionic character will increase if the positive charge on the cation is low, larger, the size of the cation is large, and the size of the anion is smaller. Basically, if the distance from the nucleus of the cation is less, then what will happen? The nuclear influence on the outermost electron will increase. As a result, it can pull the nearby electrons around it with a greater force. As a result, the shape of the cation and the shape of the anion, which was assumed to be spherical earlier, will become distorted by the pull of this cation. As a result, there will be development of some covalent character. That covalent character depends upon higher positive charge on the cation, smaller cation, as well as larger anion. And we discussed about two properties. First is polarizing power of the cation and polarizability of the anion. Polarizing power. Polarizing power of the cation and polarizability of anion. So if I represent polarizing power of cation by a function phi, then phi equals to, it is the ratio between charge and radius. That means the polarizing power is directly proportional to charge, because as the charge on a cation increases, gradually its size decreases, and it is inversely proportional to its radius. That is, if radius becomes smaller and smaller, distance from the nucleus gets reduced. As a result, the hold of the nucleus on the outermost electron increases, thereby increasing the polarizing power. The second is polarizability of the anion, which is directly proportional to charge as well as directly proportional to radius, right? So if charge on the anion is increasing gradually, it will result in increase in size, because anion is formed by gain of electrons, right? So if the charge on the anion is gradually increasing, then its size will also increase. Therefore, it can be, or its distance from its own nucleus will gradually decrease. As a result, under the influence of the nucleus of the positive charge, it can be easily distorted. As well as, if radius will increase, the same situation will happen. The distance from the nucleus again will increase, and it will be easily distorted by the positive charge. So there are two factors which determines the percentage of covalent character: higher the polarizing power of the cation and higher the polarizability of the anion, greater will be the covalent character in the ionic bond. This was basically talked about by Faison, and this is called as Faison's rule. Now, what are the application of Faison's rule? Okay, so we'll move on to the application of Faison's rule. Application of Faison's rule. So the first application is, it talks about the ionic bond and covalent bond, or the covalent character in ionic bond. So we can say basically the nature of bonds. It gives information about the nature of bonds. The second most important application is, it talks about the melting points of compounds. The melting point of ionic compounds. How? So in case of ionic, when we were studying about the properties of ionic bond, we said ionic compounds basically have higher melting and boiling point. But if we see that in an ionic bond, the percentage of covalent character or the amount of covalent character is high, then obviously the melting point will be lowered as compared to its absorbed character. Now, third is the solubility. It gives information about solubility of ionic compounds. Basically, here this is important if we try to compare the solubility or melting point of two different compounds, right? So when we try to compare the solubility or the melting point of different compounds, then this rule comes handy. How? We will deal with some questions later now. Okay, so the first question is, compare the ionic character of NaCl and CuCl. So this is an important concept. It is a very important question in terms of like examination point of view. And here also we are going to learn about a new concept. So first see, if I compare NaCl and CuCl, the charges here, the anion is same in both the case. So comparison will be done on the basis of the cation. Now let us see the charge. First let us see the charge of the cation. Here Na exists as plus 1 and copper also exists as plus 1. So charges of the cation is also same. Next we will move on to size. So if I compare the size of sodium and copper, then technically the electronic configuration of sodium is 11. So 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s1. Okay, and if I see the size of copper, its atomic number is 29 and its configuration is argon 18, 3d10, 4s1. So if I compare the size, here copper comes to be, or copper forms a bigger size than sodium. So technically what we have observed here is, if we compare only size, then what we observe, copper is bigger in size, therefore its distorting or polarizing power will be less than sodium. Hence sodium should technically have more covalent character, right? Copper should have more ionic character. But experimentally it has been observed that copper chloride is more covalent than NaCl. Why? See, copper is formed, this here copper exists as plus 1 and sodium exists as plus 1, the same. Now the configuration of copper becomes argon 18, 3d10, after losing one electron, that is in plus 1 oxidation state, copper shows this electronic configuration. Now if I compare sodium, Na plus, its configuration is 1s2, 2s2, 2p6. Now see, here in case of copper, the 3d orbital is fully filled. Okay, the 3d orbital is fully filled and therefore it shows pseudo noble gas electronic configuration. So those elements that show the pseudo noble gas electronic configuration, there the concept arises of shielding effect. What is shielding effect? The protection of penultimate electrons or the outermost electrons from the influence of the nucleus, and the shielding effect decreased in the order s p d f, because their distance from the nucleus and their size wise if we compare, then the shielding effect comes out to be this. Now here in case of copper, d orbitals are involved, and d if we compare offer poor shielding effect as compared to p. Therefore this is not able to minimize the influence of the nucleus on the outermost shell. Therefore copper plus exhibits or copper plus experiences a greater nuclear pull on its outermost electron. Therefore, it shows greater covalent character as compared to NaCl. So, if I now write the order of ionic character, then sodium chloride turns out to be more ionic as compared to copper chloride. But if we compare only the charge and radius factor, then copper chloride should ideally be more ionic than NaCl, but this is not the case due to pseudo noble gas electronic configuration. Now moving on to the second question. Arrange the following in the ascending order of their melting point. Okay, so while we discuss melting point, we need to keep a thing in mind. Ionic bonds or ionic compounds show greater melting point than covalent compounds. So here basically we will need to compare the percentage of ionic character. If the percentage of ionic character is more, then their melting point will be more. And here we need to arrange them in the ascending order. So if I compare NaCl, MgCl2 and AlCl3, again here the anion is same in all the three cases. Now let us see the charge over the cation. Na plus 1, Mg plus 2, aluminium plus 3. So if I see the charge, Al3 plus is having the maximum charge, and what we learnt, the polarizing power is directly proportional to charge. So charge increased, then percentage of covalent character will increase, thereby decreasing the ionic character. So here AlCl3 is least ionic than MgCl2. Again, MgCl2 here is less ionic than NaCl. So now if I write the order of their melting point, highest melting point will be shown by NaCl because it is very highly ionic as compared to MgCl2 and AlCl3, and least melting point will be shown by AlCl3. So the order in ascending order becomes AlCl3 less than MgCl2 less than NaCl. Next question is, PCl5 exists but NCl5 does not. Okay, we observe a compound with the formula PCl5, but nitrogen pentachloride we haven't heard of. Why? So if I compare the electronic configurations again, nitrogen is having atomic number 7 and phosphorus is having atomic number 15. So if I try to write the electronic configurations over here, let us take a fresh page. So if I take nitrogen 7, its electronic configuration is 1s2, 2s2, 2p3. If I take phosphorus 15, the electronic configuration turns out to be 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p4. Okay, this is the electronic configuration of phosphorus and this is the electronic configuration of nitrogen. So if I see, when nitrogen forms NCl5, here it requires another two more half filled orbitals to occupy two chlorine extra chlorine atoms, and again here also phosphorus requires two unpaired electrons, two extra orbitals to occupy two extra chlorine atoms. But see, the difference is here it is the outermost shell is second orbit, and here the outermost shell is the third orbit. So in case of third orbit, when gradually we move from first, second to the third orbit, there is the introduction of another 3d orbital, right? But in case of second orbit, there is no possibility of any chances of expansion of its electron or expansion of its orbitals, because in the second orbit there are no d electrons involved. So in case of phosphorus can expand its octet to 3d, thereby generating extra orbitals, and hence there is possibility of formation of PCl5. But due to lack of extra orbitals or due to the inability of nitrogen to expand its octet beyond p, there is no possibility of the formation of NCl5. Okay, I hope you might understand this question, and this is also a very important question. The next is, the correct order of solubility in aqueous medium, the order of solubility. Again, what we learned, ionic compounds are more soluble as compared to covalent compounds because of separation of charges, right? So here also we need to compare the ionic character. More the ionic character, more is the solubility. So here what happens, the cation remains the same in all the three cases. Varies, what varies is the anion. Again, here it is -1, -1, -1. All the valencies or the charges of the anion is same. Now what we need to compare is the size of the anion. So if I see the size of fluorine, chlorine and bromine, they belong to the halogen group, right? And what we learned, as we move down the group, what happens? The size gradually increases because of addition of newer cells. Okay, so what happens to the size? Fluorine, chlorine, bromine, the size gradually increases going down the group. So what will happen? In Poisson's rule, what we learned, the polarizability of the anion is directly proportional to its size. Greater the size, greater will be the polarizability and greater will be the covalent character. So NaBr here is the most covalent, then NaCl, then Na(I). Right? This is the order of covalent character. What will be the order of ionic character? Just the opposite. Sorry, this is NaF. NaF. This is the order of covalent character. Ionic character will be just the opposite, and more the ionic character, more is the solubility. So this is the order of solubility of ionic compounds. So in this lecture, we have learnt about the application of Fizeau's rule and few probable questions that usually comes in the examinations. I hope with this you are clear with the application and what exactly was Fizeau's rule. Thank you.